Hello, my name is Dami, and this is Ask Dami. This is the place where you receive practical answers to life's complex questions, and it's the ninth episode. This week's question, real quick. This person says, lately, bitterness has been my close pal. Has that happened to you before? Some people hurt me so bad, and I think I have forgiven them, but whenever I see them, I still feel bitter. What should I do? Anonymous. Now, this person is basically asking, how can I forgive when it hurts so much, or why do I feel the way I feel even though I think I have forgiven those who hurt me? Remember the last week we talked about betrayal and the fact that betrayal hurts regardless of how super spiritual you may feel or how exposed you are in the things of God. But what I want to say this week is start out by saying that betrayal hurts, but bitterness kills. And many times we're dealing with bitterness, or we've forgiven people, and we still have this after effects, this gut-wrenching feeling anytime they're around us. Or maybe we've even forgiven them, but every time we see them, there's a trigger that is not quite nice. I will attempt tonight or today to interpret many of those feelings and to put things in perspective. But I want to use this opportunity to also talk to somebody who's struggling with bitterness, unforgiveness, somebody who's been badly hurt, somebody who's been disappointed, heartbroken, mistreated, maltreated. You know, if you're that person, I just want to encourage you along a few lines that don't allow that degenerate to bitterness, because bitterness is a lot more expensive than many people realize. There are a few quotes I'd like to share with you today before going into a scriptural verse and proffering five things you can do to ensure that you deal decisively and exhaustively with bitterness. So, the first one is this one. I like it. It says, unforgiveness is choosing to stay trapped in a jail cell of bitterness, serving time for someone else's crime. So when you linger along in unforgiveness and you don't deal with it, you're like somebody who's staying in a prison, serving time for somebody else's crime. Now, there's another one that you like. It says, bitterness is a root that ruins the garden of peace. When we hold on to disappointment, a poisonous root of bitterness begins to grow. Like the Bible talks about the root of bitterness. One of the things about a root is that the root produces a shoot, and the shoot produces fruit. So whenever bitterness is permitted to thrive and it begins to grow and it begins to spread, what happens is a whole lot of negative things are birthed. They are produced. Then there is this one by Maya Angelou. She says that bitterness is like cancer. It eats upon the host, but anger is like fire. It burns all clean. So at this point, let me begin to make some distinctions. Bitterness is not the same thing as anger. Anger is an emotional outburst based on a certain disappointment or displeasure that you feel. But bitterness is when you allow your anger get to unforgiveness and then degenerates to resentment, and then it becomes wrath and you begin to seethe. And what happens with bitterness is that it grows, it festers, it grows, it festers, it burgeons, it snowballs into something out of hand. It's important that we deal with bitterness. Another quote, bitterness is like drinking poison and waiting for the other person to die. And that's exactly what happens. So what is the key thing here? When we look at the book of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 31 through 32 says, get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Now, this is a very serious scripture. It's challenging when it is that you've been hurt, you've been badly treated, mistreated, maltreated. And God says, get rid of all of the bitterness, get rid of all the rage and all of the anger. When Jesus taught us how to pray, he says, when you pray, say, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. So we're commanded to forgive. We're commanded to overlook wrong. We're commanded to go beyond the boundaries of wrath and anger and displeasure and disappointment to exemplify the very heart of God. That can be very tough, but it's what we're commanded to do. So I know maybe he cheated on you. Maybe she walked out on you. Maybe your leader disappointed you or led you astray. Maybe somebody didn't tell you the whole truth and you found out that they had been doing all kinds of crazy things behind your back. Whatever it is, God says, I want you to forgive totally, wholly, and completely to forgive. How does that work? What are the steps I can take? The first thing is you have to be honest. And like the person who's asked this question says that every time I see them, I just feel that gut-wrenching feeling. It's like a nasty feeling in my heart. Now, you have to be honest with yourself. And honesty is in different, I should say, along different lines. First of all, being honest to know that you were hurt, you were upset. Now, also being honest to know that you've forgiven them in some cases, but the feelings are still there. So honesty helps because it helps you to know what part of the healing process you're in. Honesty with yourself, honesty with God, and honesty with the people if you can seek audience with them. Number two, you need to ask God for help because there are some things that people do to you that, I mean, you're like, God, I mean, how can I deal with this? How can I handle this? Imagine the case of your spouse just on you. I mean, that's just a whole lot to deal with, and you need God's help. God says, I will send you a comfort. I will send you a help. I will send you the Holy Spirit. So ask God for help in prayer and say, God, you know that I've been badly treated, mistreated, maltreated, but I trust you for help to help me through this phase. Number three, don't force the feeling. Now, notice that what God commands us to do. God commands us to love people. He does not command us to feel good about them. Now, I need to bring a balance to that before somebody out there crucifies me. Love is not a feeling. Love is a decision. Love is not a feeling because God commands us to love, and you can't command people to feel. I can't command you to feel excited. I can't command you to feel angry. I can't command you to feel good. A feeling is something that evolves naturally based on a given set of circumstances and situations. However, we're commanded to love. Now, sometimes it takes a while before your decision to love is translated to feelings of love. Sometimes it takes a while before your love for somebody evolves into you're liking that person. So don't force the feeling. Let it be something that happens naturally. Go with the acts of love. Be good to them. Be kind-hearted towards them. Go out of your way to do good things. And then when you begin to do that, when you put your mind, your heart, and your soul along those lines of love, your emotions will eventually follow. Many times your will will determine the direction of your emotions. Number four, seek audience. By seeking audience, you want to seek audience with the person or seek audience with somebody who has access to the person. Case in point, if somebody has really upset you in church and the person is in a position of authority over you, you don't have direct access to the person, you might want to look for somebody, another leader in church or another person on his or her level or somebody who has a degree of maturity to be able to resolve the conflict. Number five, give them another chance. Now, I know that this sounds absolutely ridiculous because you're like, oh no, I'll have nothing to do with that person again. But it is usually dangerous when we form permanent opinions in temporary situations. In a case where the person has abused many chances and abuse many opportunities to right their wrongs and to grow and develop their character in the things of God, you might want to back up a little bit, but give people another chance. Don't just say, oh, because this person messed up the last time, I would never give the person another chance. I understand what it feels like to have your trust shattered I understand what it feels like to have people walk all over your heart, but you need to give it another chance. I hope that this helps somebody, and I hope that this helps you out there. Don't forget that your decision to love is what sets the tone for your personal healing and what sets the tone for the healing of your relationship with that person who's upset you. So, like I said last week, I want to reiterate it. Develop a culture of love. Develop a lifestyle of love. The Bible says the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts. There are some people who are in your life for the sole purpose of helping you demonstrate the love of God. What is the love of God? It is selfless. It's sacrificial. It's good to love people when they're lovable. I mean, it's easy to love people when they're lovable. But what happens when they're just acting nasty? That is an opportunity to show the kind of love that God has demonstrated towards you. And I just want to pray with you right now that God will safeguard your heart and pour out a strength into every area of weakness, that you will enjoy healing, absolute wholeness, and that if your heart is broken the way or the other, God himself will fix it in the mighty name of Jesus. I hope that this helps you. Send this to somebody who needs it. But let's connect on Twitter and on Facebook and on YouTube. Send in your questions and your comments, and send this to somebody you know is going through a hard time and a difficult time, fixing a relationship that has gone sour, fixing a heart that has been broken through diverse disappointments and denials and delays. It's been great sharing a few thoughts with you again today on Ask Dami. I hope to talk to you sometime soon, but remember that you are the answer to somebody's question. You're the solution to somebody's problem. Go out there and make a positive difference, because the world is waiting for you.